Dr. Yoram Solomon is the author of the Book of Trust and 12 more books, 22 patents, more than 300 articles, and was one of the creators of Wi-Fi and USB 3.0. Yoram is also an adjunct professor of entrepreneurship at the Southern Methodist University, teaching the four components of business success: differentiation, unique target market, competitive advantage, and a viable business model. Most recently, though, Dr. Solomon hosts his very own popular podcast, The Trust Show, on Apple Podcasts. Wow, that's a lot. Dr. Solomon, welcome, welcome, welcome. It's so wonderful to see you today.
Hey, Ron, great to be with you again.
We decided that we're going to focus today only on what is the difference between differentiation and competitive advantage. So what is the difference between differentiation and competitive advantage?
Well, let me start. Let me go back for a second. You touched on those four components of what makes a business successful. And this was actually something that came out of, about 9 years ago. I think I was invited to speak in something that's called Startup Weekend, where 200 something entrepreneurs came in to one place. And it's kind of a boot camp. It's a weekend. And they all worked and built their own programs. And right. I was asked as the keynote speaker to give them some advice. And so that was actually the point in time where I came up with those four components. And they asked me, what is it that would make a business successful? And I realized it's four things. The first one is you have to do something that's different. You have to have a differentiation.
Absolutely.
So I'll call it a unique product. And by the way, whenever I say product, it's also a service or a business model or a process, whatever it is, I'm just going to refer to it as a product. So you have to have a unique product that offers unique value to a unique set of customers. Right. And that's key, because typically when people look at businesses, they starting a business, they go, and who's going to be our market? Well, everybody can use my product. Yes, everybody can use your product. But if you make a product that you're trying to address everybody's needs, you have something that's a commodity. You don't have something that's unique. Right. It's always to identify, and that's the second component, the unique set of customers, identify the thing that makes your product unique, or the differentiation, I should say, the differentiation makes it unique to that set of customers. So these are two: unique products offering a unique value to a unique set of customers. The third one is you have to maintain competitive advantage. And in a minute, I'll talk about the difference between differentiation and competitive advantage. And so now that you have competitive advantage, this is you versus competitors. The fourth one is, oh, by the way, how do I make money out of it? So is there a viable business model where we make money? And there are some interesting cases in history where people did not make money, yet were managed to sell companies for a lot of money. And I can talk about that. But you specifically asked about the difference between differentiation and competitive advantage. These are two components, or two terms, that are often confused or exchanged, and they're not. They're very, very different. And I'll tell you another funny story. So I teach this class at SMU, and in that class, one of the questions that I asked in a quiz was, what is the difference between differentiation and competitive advantage? Well, I'm reading the answers that my students gave me, and all of a sudden I read one answer and I thought, that was so brilliant that I'm going to have to repeat this in class next week. So what it said, what the answer was, the difference between differentiation and competitive advantage is differentiation enter the market. Competitive advantage closes the door behind you once you're inside and prevents your competitors from entering. I thought that was a brilliant definition.
So bear with me a moment, Dr. Solomon. For some reason, we got frozen there for a second. I'm not sure where it came from, but if you would, just because I think that definition is important, if you wouldn't mind, repeat the definition one more time for us, please.
Okay, so I'll go back to the definition. And again, the story is this was a question that I put in a quiz.
Right.
And one of my students answered that differentiation is what opens the door for you to enter the market.
Right.
Competitive advantage is what closes the door behind you and prevents your competitors from entering the market.
I love that. That's absolutely wonderful.
And I'll explain it in a minute, but to finish that story, I thought this was a brilliant answer, and I wanted to put that answer next week in class and share it with everyone. I keep on reading the quizzes that my students have completed, and all of a sudden I see somebody else saying exactly the same thing, using exactly the same words. Differentiation is what opens the door to let you into the market. Competitive advantage is what closes the door behind you, preventing competitors from entering. And I'm going, well, they must have worked together, which, by the way, I never tell my students, but I don't have an issue if all of you work together on the quiz. All I need is for you to know the answer. I don't care if you came up with it.
Where were you when I was in college? Go ahead. Yeah.
Then I get the same answer a third time. And I'm going, okay, I can tell who worked together. And so the next week in class, I said, you know, I'm going to quote one of the students. And as it turns out, three students gave the same answer because I thought this was brilliant. And so I was giving kudos to my students, saying, you came up with a brilliant definition. Differentiation is what opens the door to enter the market, let you enter the market. Competitive advantage closes the door behind you. And they look at me kind of funny and they go, well, you said it in class last week. I had no recollection of saying this. And so since I record my own classes so that students will have access to it, especially when they're about to do a quiz, I went and I checked. I did say it in class. I just didn't remember saying it. So let me break it down, or unpack, as we say. Let me unpack the definition. Nobody is going to let you into the market. If you're a small business, you just started your business, you're not a Microsoft, you're not a Google, you're not an Uber, you're not a Tesla. Nobody will let you into the market if the product that you have, and again, product, service, process, business model, nobody would let you into the market if your product is the same as everybody else.
Right.
You don't have anything unique that adds value to that specific room you're trying to enter, so that specific market segment. If you don't have anything unique, why would anybody buy from you? You know, Ron, you probably remember this phrase, it will date us, but nobody ever gets fired from choosing IBM.
Yeah.
Remember that?
Yeah.
And really what that meant was, if you are... If you're an IT manager and you need to buy this new system, and IBM is making it, and there's this little startup that's making something that's maybe even better, at least on paper.
Right.
And you go, you know what? I think we can get more value, or more value for the money, if we go with this little startup. The thing is, what you're afraid of is you're going to buy it and you're going to find that it's not as good, or it's not going to work well, or it's going to break down and there are going to be consequences to the organization. You're thinking, I'm going to get fired. But you buy IBM or Microsoft or Google or Amazon or one of the bigger companies, and it doesn't work out. Hey, what do you want from me? I bought from the market leader, right? So this is why, unless you do something that's really unique, that's really differentiated, you don't get into that market. Nobody's going to buy from you. I love it when entrepreneurs, I'm being facetious. I love it when an entrepreneur comes to me and says, hey, this market is $2.7 billion. All I need is 1% of this market, which would be $27 million, and I'm happy as a clam. Well, why do you think anybody will give you 1% of this market? If you're doing the same thing that another company in that market is getting 99% of market share, why do you think there's 1% of people that will buy from you? What is it that you're offering that would overcome the fact that you're so small and so young as a company? Well, so that's the importance of differentiation.
So look, forgive me for interrupting, but what you're talking about, though, is if you go into a marketplace and there's really nothing different about you, it's not a matter of necessarily whether anybody's going to buy from you, but you're going to wind up competing on price because that's the only thing you have left. So if I'm selling widgets and my widgets are just like everybody else's widgets, there's nothing really different about them, then I'm going to be left with only one option when it comes to marketing. And that's going to be to sell my widgets cheaper than the guy down the street. But that's going to do nothing to help me build a loyal client base that's going to keep me in business for in the long term. Is that, would that be a safe assessment?
I am so glad you brought this up.
I had my
one of the questions that I ask my students is, can you differentiate on price? Can you differ? And that's exactly what you suggested, Ron. You suggested I'm going to go there on a lower price.
Right.
The answer is you can differentiate on price with one condition, and that condition has to exist. You must have a structural cost advantage. Because if it costs you the same as it costs to the bigger guy, and by the way, just keep in mind one thing. You're a startup. You're making things in much smaller quantities. They probably have the economies of scale. Their cost is lower than yours. You want to lower your price? You know what they're going to do? They're going to lower their price. And you know something? Because their cost is lower than yours, they can lower their price lower than yours. They can lower their price lower than your cost. You're going to have to sell at a loss. So there are companies that enter on price. There's a book from the 1990s called Disciplines of Market Leaders, and Treacy and Wurzima are the authors. They claim that there are three ways you can differentiate. You can differentiate on having the best product.
Right. So
if it's a car, obviously, BMW, right? Just say yes.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. BMW is the best car. Well, BMW is the best car in a certain category. Other cars can be the best in other categories.
Right.
So there's the best product. The second category is customer intimacy. So we take care of everything that you do. So that, think Intuit, TurboTax, QuickBooks, everything that Intuit does, they kind of get you wrapped around with all the services that you might need. And the third is, they call it operational excellence, and it's really the lowest price. So think about the cheap airlines, right? So there's Frontier,
right,
and trying to remember the name of the other one, the
yellow
Spirit. Airline. No, Southwest used to be that, but these companies even took it to the extreme. So they're offering prices that are lower than their competitors. Let's say American Airlines. Can American Airlines or United lower their prices to the point where they can compete with Frontier and Spirit? The answer is no. And the reason is because American Airlines or United, they do so many things around that flight, like transferring your baggage. I don't know if you ever flew on Frontier or Spirit.
Frontier.
I went up there. I looked. I counted how many people are seating. This is, Ron, this is the first time I ever saw 246 people on an Airbus 320.
Wow.
246. There are six people in a row. The seats are, you know, the seats are what you would put in a stadium. I mean, they're cheap plastic seats.
Right.
They don't fold. They don't go back. I opened the tray, and the first thing that went through my head is, where's the rest of it? There is nothing. But you know what? For those short flights, what do you need? You don't need anything more than that. They can squeeze 246 people into that plane, and that is a very efficient plane. Pilot training is very efficient because there is only one type of plane and so on. Take all of this together and you get a structural cost advantage. Well, you can lower your price if you have a structural cost advantage. So again, to your point, you want to enter the market, you want to compete on price, you better have a structural cost advantage or your competitors will just lower the price and meet you there. And once again, you're out of the market. Let me touch on another point that since we're talking about differentiation before I go to talk about competitive advantage and the difference between them. But on differentiation, I remember, and you know, to the viewers, if you're a startup company and you may have heard this phrase before, you will only win in business if you have a 10x improvement over existing products, 10x improvement. Well, let me ask you a question. we went with TVs from standard definition, which was 480 lines, right, or 480p. We went to high definition. Initially, high definition was really 720p, and then it was 1080p, which is full high definition. Then you have 4K, which is really twice or four times the amount of pixels, and 8K. Well, the interesting question is the transition from standard definition to 4K is actually 27 times more. You have 27 times higher resolution, really. Is it worth 27 times the price? No, not really. So a 10x improvement may not necessarily suggest a 10x differentiation, specifically because you care about the value that your differentiation brings. But I posed a challenge to my students. I asked them, can there be a case where your performance or the performance of your product is only 10% higher, and this will be 10x differentiation, 10x the value, or even more? Can you think of improving your performance by only 10%?
I personally think it's possible.
I'm going to give you a few examples. So one example is there is a certain amount of acceleration that you need to take a missile and get it out of the Earth's gravity if you want to go to, let's say, the moon or Mars. Well, if you're 10x short, 10% sure of that, heck, if you're 5% sure of that, you're not leaving Earth's gravity. Another one, if we are competing in a Grand Prix car race, right? What if my car is only 10% faster than yours? I win every time, pretty much. I mean, I need to put a decent driver and I win,
right?
But here's the best example I gave them. Let's say that we're in the business of building boilers, water boilers. My boiler can boil water up to 200 degrees Fahrenheit. Your boiler is just a little better. It can go to 212 degrees Fahrenheit. So not even 10%, 6% better than mine. Does it create 10 times differentiation?
I wouldn't think so, no.
Unless you want to put that boiler in a locomotive. Because you know something funny that happens at 212 degrees Fahrenheit?
What?
The waters boil and they create steam and your locomotive starts moving, because at 200 degrees, all you have is hot water. 6% differentiation that gives you all the difference in the world. One locomotive is just not moving. The other one is driving, is carrying a rail. So I don't want entrepreneurs to say differentiation must be 10 times. It can be 10%. It can be 6%. It must provide, and this is the test for really good differentiation, it must provide unique value that a unique set of customers care about. But I still owe you an answer to your question. What is the difference between differentiation and competitive advantage?
Okay.
So, and those two get confused very, very often and used interchangeably, and they should not. And the way sometimes people, and I want to say it up front and I'm going to say it at the end, this is the wrong way to define competitive advantage. They say that competitive advantage is how my product is better than the other products. That's not competitive advantage. That's differentiation. How my product is different, is better than other, and in some cases, in some instances or some parameters, it might be worse. It's just that our customers don't care about those that much. Take cars, when you compare cars, how fast does it accelerate? Well, how fuel efficient is it? How cheap is it? You can see that if you start looking at different customers, you know, the customer who is in the top 1% of earners, who does not have kids at home and wants a car for fun, you know, they're going to care about the brand. They're going to care about how fast it goes from 0 to 100. They're going to care about fuel efficiency. Not so much. You know, are they going to care about price? Not so much. I'm in the top 1%. someone who's using the car for work, not to drive to work, but actually for work,
right.
Deliveries, for example, you're in pizza delivery. Do you care about how fast it goes, 0 to 100?
No.
Nope. Do you care about fuel efficiency?
Yes.
Oh, yes. You care about reliability. So you care about the price. So different customers care about different things. So when you compare your product to other products, this is differentiation. And it has to be done through the lenses, through the perspective of your target market. Can I sell a Ferrari to someone who wants to sell pizza? Yes, I can. Will they buy it? They may, probably not. You need to focus on who cares. So differentiation is in the eyes of this customer that cares. Competitive advantage is how you defend your differentiation. There is something that allows you to differentiate, and I call that the differentiation enabler. So the differentiation enabler is, for example, let's go back to our boilers. The fuel that I use to heat the water, I use different fuel than yours. My fuel allows me to heat water to 212, yours doesn't. It only allows me to heat the water for 200. So that differentiator, this is the thing that enables, and it can be the process that I'm using, it can be the technology that I'm using or other things. That's the thing that I'm trying to protect. How do I protect it? That's my competitive advantage. There are 5 components to competitive advantage. 1, trade secret, secret sauce. This is how Coca-Cola protects their formula. They did not file for a patent because Coca-Cola, I think, started in 1886.
Right.
No way for you to check it now, but 1886. If they had filed for a patent, that patent would have expired in 1906. That's it. And from that moment on, everybody knows how to make Coca-Cola. They kept it as a trade secret or secret sauce.
Right.
The second one is a patent. Patents, you know, when you file a patent, especially in the technology space, and you go, well, 20 years is so long. I mean, this is forever. My first patent was filed in 1996. It has expired in 2016. My first patent has already expired. I need to check and see how many of my other patents have expired. So that's patent. Patent is legal protection of your intellectual property.
Okay.
The third one is what I call men years. Now, I apologize. I'm not being sexist. This is how we refer to the phrase. It's called men years. How much work was put into it to get to where I am today, to get to where we are, to where the technology is? And can somebody emulate it very quickly?
Okay.
Fourth one, first mover advantage. One of the worst ones that people bring up, because so many people go, oh, I'm going to be the first to market. Yes, but is it sustainable? So there were a few research articles written that I like, and Suarez and Lenzola, those are their names. I'm not making up those names. Trust me. See the trust bill there. So I'm not making up those names, but they wrote articles about the fallacies or the half-truths of first mover advantage. Two things must happen for you to have, well, to have the first mover advantage, you have that simply by being first with something unique. The question is, can you keep it? Is it sustainable for a long term? And for it to be sustainable for a long term, you have to come up with two things: slow rate of adoption and slow rate of technology evolution. And I'm not going to go into too much detail, but as long as you can maintain these two, technology is moving very slow. Think vacuum cleaners, the technology until Dyson, you know, Dyson made a change, but even that's, you know, it's been a while. When was the last time you saw any evolution, technology evolution in vacuum cleaners? So slow adoption and slow technology evolution. And that leaves the fifth one. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, the fifth one is unique access to resources. I'm going to ask you a question. If you had to characterize Facebook customers, how would you characterize them?
Facebook.
Give me one characteristic, one demographic.
How would I characterize Facebook customers?
Yes. Give me one characteristic, one demographic characteristic.
Wow. I'm apathetic, I guess. I mean, I don't really see Facebook. I've never really had any great luck with customers on Facebook. So I'm going to say apathetic because they just don't seem to, they don't connect, I guess, with advertising on Facebook.
See, that's a mistake that a lot of people say when I ask about Facebook customers. If we go to the dictionary definition of customer, you're going to find in the first line of the definition, someone who pays for whatever it is you're selling.
Right, right.
What you're describing is Facebook users. Facebook customers are those who advertise. Facebook, I believe, makes about 70. No, Facebook makes more than 90% of the revenue from advertisement. Google makes more than 70% of the revenue comes from advertisement.
So that was a trick question.
It was a trick question. And thank you for playing along.
So, glad I could help.
Yeah, the customer is the person who actually pays. Those are users. But you know what those users are? They are the fifth type of competitive advantage. They are unique access to resources, because what Facebook sells to you is the access to these resources,
right,
or users. So, and here's the story. You know, when I got my law degree in 98, so 97, I took a class. That was the class that I thought I was going to fail. And I actually failed the first time. I had to take it a second time. It was tax law.
Right.
And I was certain that I'm going to fail the second time. I mean, I barely passed. I'm going to fail the second time and I will never get my law degree. I ended up passing by two points. The question we got was, there was a company in Israel called Mirabilis. Their product was called ICQ. Do you remember ICQ, Ron?
No, I don't.
ICQ was the first instant messenger. And so it's three letters.
Oh, yeah, yeah, ICQ. Okay.
Yeah. So it was made by four Israelis that just finished military service. And they came over to the US and they built this company, ICQ. And I tried it and it worked. It was beautiful and I loved it, except that they had absolutely no way to make money. They violated that fourth law of how you build a business, a successful business. There was no way to make money on an instant messenger. In 97, the test that I got on tax law was to estimate, not estimate, but determine how much tax will they need to pay on selling their company for America Online for $407 million.
Wow.
They sold that company for $407 million with zero revenue and not even a plan on how you can make revenue. The reason was this: they had 12 million subscribers. At that time, when not everybody had internet, right, access, America Online said, look, we did the math and it cost about $50 to acquire a new customer. And you know, customer acquisition costs.
Right.
So in marketing, sales, everything altogether, it cost us $50 to get a new customer. If we buy ICQ with 12 million subscribers and we pay less than $600 million, it's the same. It's going to cost us the same, except we get $12 million in one shot.
Wow.
They ended up paying $34 per customer. 34 times 12 million, pretty much $407 million.
Wow.
That was the advantage that ICQ had, was the fifth type, and that is unique access to resources.
So real quick, because I was trying to write these down and listen at the same time. So the five elements of that were trade secrets, correct? Patents. And then you said Minier. Is that one word or two words?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Either one word or two
okay,
words.
Okay. Right, so Minier. I guess I got lost on the fourth one. The fifth one I know is unique access to resources. What was the fourth element?
First mover advantage. First mover advantage, but again, only if the only reason why this would be an advantage is if it's any one of them would be an advantage is if it's a sustainable advantage, if you can sustain it for long term. And so the fact that you're going to say, oh, you know what, I'm going to do something that's unique and I'm going to be the first to market with it, you might be right. You're the first to market. So you have your first mover advantage. The question is, can you sustain it for more than a month until Google does the same thing?
Right.
Or anybody else copies you. So there were two conditions to the fourth one, the first mover advantage, and that's slow adoption rate and slow rate of technology evolution.
Okay. So I have another question. It's on topic, off topic, because you keep talking about one of the things you mentioned quite a bit is talking about, as an example, the delivery guy. What is the delivery guy going to care about? Is he going to care about getting the 0 to 100 in no time at all? Is he going to care about fuel efficiency? What is this guy going to care about? So my question to you, and I know the answer should be fairly obvious, but I'm curious from your point of view, how am I as a business owner, or how is any business owner supposed to know what their customers may or may not find of value?
This is a great question.
Thank you.
So I want to touch on something else or kind of lead to that with, I developed an interesting tool. Okay. I developed an interesting tool for differentiation. And what it does is it's a spreadsheet. Really, it's a spreadsheet. I even built it on Google Sheets. No. I take it back. I developed it on Excel. I may convert it to Google Sheets. And what it does is it asks you a series of questions. And at the end, it gives you a percentage. And the percentage is, what is the probability that this customer will buy your product over the competitor?
Okay.
How would you like that? It's 91%, it's 33% or whatever. The thing is, this is one of those things where it's garbage in, garbage out. And that leads to some of the questions in the tool are exactly along the line of what you just asked. And that is, how do I know what the customer cares about? Well, there are several ways to know that. And you know what, I'm going to lump into that the question that Mike asked on chat. He said, what did Coca-Cola do when they tried to reinvent themselves back in the 1980s?
Okay.
So here is the Coca-Cola story. What happened was Coca-Cola was the market leader until one day Pepsi came along and Pepsi started grabbing market share.
Right.
Coca-Cola got really nervous. And what they did was they did taste tests. So they brought people, they gave them two glasses. They said, drink this versus drink that. And just overall, with overwhelming advantage, people just preferred Pepsi over Coke.
Right.
They got really nervous. They tried to estimate to understand the difference. What they realized was Pepsi was sweeter. And so they said, you know what? We're going to come up with something even sweeter than Pepsi, and we're going to call it New Coke. You may remember that.
So I remember it. Yeah, I remember New Coke.
They did their taste test, and what they found out was people preferred New Coke over Pepsi and Pepsi over Old Coke. And then they went out with New Coke, and you remember what happened? People just said, bring the Old Coke back.
Right. What are you
doing? What's wrong with you? Bring Old Coke back. And so what really happened was that they did not do what you were asking well. And that is really understand the customer, because putting me in front of two glasses, telling me I'm going to pay you $25. All you have to do, drink two glasses. Tell me which one you like better. That's it. That's all you have to do. Guess how I'm drinking it? As fast as I can. Right.
Right.
When you want to drink it fast, you want it to be sweeter. How do you typically drink a soft drink? Not as fast as you can.
No.
Drinking alongside a meal. You drink it while watching TV or something. For that, you don't want it to be that sweet. You want it to be less sweet. And so what they did, their mistake back then, and by the way, they came back with something that was called Classic Coke until there was no more New Coke, and they could just drop the Classic Coke and go back to just calling it Coca-Cola. Well, so you need to really understand your customers. There are different ways to understand your customers. You know, Coca-Cola tried taste tests, but that was taking the customer away from, I'm going to call them, their natural habitat.
Right.
And, you know, when I talk about natural habitat, it's just like, this is my natural habitat, right? So they took the customers away from the natural habitat and the way that they typically operate and tried to understand why, you know, or answer the question, is this product better than another? You can't. you have to live in their shoes. Now, you don't have to be them. Right. You don't have to be them. But too many companies I see are trying to characterize those customers without really knowing them. You remember Nokia? Nokia at some point was the market leader with cell phones with more than 60% market share. Right. More than 60% market share. Where are they today? Well, at some point, they thought that the customer is them. Finnish engineers who live in Helsinki. Well, as it turns out, that's not all of the customers. You know who was really great at that? There are two people that come to mind that were really great in identifying customer needs.
And they
are. One of them, Henry Ford, said, if I had asked them what they wanted, they would have said faster horses. And he said, that's not what they need. I understand them. Who's the other one?
Steve Jobs.
Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs, who he could get into somebody else's mind and know what they're going to like. Before they came up with iPhone in 2007 or iPod in 2001, they didn't go and ask people, would you like a device? You know, let's talk about the iPod in 2001. Would you like a device that has could hold 1,000 songs? That was the first iPod with 10 megabytes. Could hold 1,000 songs and you can keep it in your pocket. Of course, there was Walkman and the Discman and all. Would you like a device like that? It's a different model. By the way, iTunes did not come out until 2004. So you couldn't even envision at that point that there's going to be an iTunes and you can get access to a single song. Don't have to buy an album anymore. They didn't ask. They just knew enough. So you can't look at a new business kind of from the side, trying to look at your customers in a very detached way. You have to live with them to understand them, to see what they what they're going through, to understand, to break down the process. There's a great technique called design. Well, it's called, what's the name? Now I'm drawing a blank, but it started in something that's called D-School. It's called design thinking. That's the name I was going for, design thinking, where really it starts, it has five components. And the first component is empathy. By the way, that takes me to, I think that the four most important qualities for entrepreneur are CPAE. Now, Ron, you're a member of NSA, so you know what CPAE is, right? Yeah, but this is a different CPAE. You have to have curiosity. You have to have pragmatism. You have to have ambition. And you have to have empathy. And empathy is not that, you know, I feel sorry for you, Ron. You know, I'm compassionate and all. No, right. Empathy is my ability to put myself, to see things from your perspective. Yeah. You know, one thing that I talk, because empathy is very important for trust. One thing when I talk about empathy in the context of trust, I explain empathy. And so you know that cats and babies have something in common. They both think that the world revolves around them.
Okay.
So babies get out of it. Cats, not so much. You can tell that I'm not a cat person. But so babies, we teach them the golden rule, right? Love thy neighbor as you'd love yourself. You want to treat others as you would like to be treated yourself. Well, I don't know about you. Do you like sushi?
No, not a fan. No.
Oh, really?
No.
Okay. I had a higher probability of you saying yes than no, but that's fine. So work with me.
Nah.
I'm going to ask again. You like sushi?
Absolutely. One of my favorite. Okay. Every day I go out to lunch sushi.
I ask people, do you like sushi? Yeah. So would it make sense? My wife, by the way, does not like sushi. She does not like seafood. She would not let sushi into the house. So would it make sense if on her birthday or for our anniversary, I'm going to take her to a sushi restaurant because that's what I'd like done on my birthday? No, it doesn't make sense. So then we say, put yourself in another person's shoes. Well, if you put yourself in their shoes are different size, different style, different color. I don't fit in their shoes. Really, empathy is your ability to see things from another person's perspective. You're familiar with the Maslow's hierarchy of needs, right? You got to keep in mind that people are not at the same level that you are. You might be at the highest level of self-fulfillment. You're trying to see if you're fulfilling your destiny in life. Other people are worried about what they're going to have to eat tomorrow. So it's your ability to see things from their perspective that makes you realize what is it that they will value in your product. And you have to define a narrow market segment. I like to give the analogy of you want to be the big fish in a small pond, and the pond is the size of the market. You don't want to be a small fish in a large pond. Right. You want to be a big fish in a small pond that's well-defined set of customers that have unique values that other customers don't, and your unique differentiation offers that unique value to them.
I see this whole idea of empathy. I mean, that, well, not just empathy, but understanding your customers as being a part of competitive advantage, because there are just so many businesses that don't do that. They don't take the time. They think they know, they're selling what they believe is what they think is in the best interest of the customer, rather than actually getting to know the internal thinkings of a customer as to whether or not they're offering them a product that's going to be of value. Yoram, this has been an incredible conversation, and I wish we had more time, because I'd love to talk about, you were talking about iTunes. I want to talk about, and you talked about old Coke versus new Coke. I'd love to know what happened to Zune. I'm sure you have a story for that at some point. Wasn't it Zune, the Microsoft version of iTunes that came out that never seemed to make it? And whatever happened to Pepsi Clear? I was thinking Pepsi Clear as you're talking about new Coke and old Coke, because I remember Pepsi Clear came out also. You don't see that anymore either. For those that are online with us right now, if you have any questions for Yoram, go ahead and throw them into the chat real quick before we wrap up, because I want to make sure that we've covered them all. Yoram, while we're waiting for questions to come in, I know that you have a new venture going on, and that is as the host of the Trust Show, I believe it is called, on Apple, an Apple podcast. Talk a little bit about that, if you will.
Yes, so definitely. It's actually not only on Apple, it's anywhere you'd like. The easiest way to get there is just type thetrustshow.com, and it will take you to links to every place where you can listen to podcasts. And this is it's unique in that I actually have no guests. I don't have any guests. I kind of, when I started doing that, I realized that what I'm doing is I'm trying to leave a legacy. I'm trying to tell the whole story, because telling the whole story is going to take a long time for me. It's in the book of trust, but every episode addresses an issue, whether it's one of the six components of trustworthiness, what makes you trustworthy? How do you know who to trust? How do you build trust? The eight laws of trust. So I think that we have recorded five episodes so far. In fact, I'm recording another episode right after this. It's just really, it's me talking. It's explaining an issue. I invite people to always send an email to yoram@thetrustshow.com, so that if you have a question about trust, in a future episode, I will answer it. But yes, it's thetrustshow.com. I'm very excited about that. It barely started. Four episodes are out. The fifth one is in the queue. Six ones will be recorded today. I have content for probably the next 400 episodes.
Well, and beyond your podcast, the way I came to know more about you was through your YouTube channel. You have an amazing, I mean, I wish I had a tenth of the content that you have on your YouTube channel, because it covers all sorts of topics beyond trust. You and I had a lot of conversations about OCB. Did I get that? OBS.
OBS.
And how to make that work. And I mean, it's phenomenal. And is it just YouTube, Yoram Solomon, or do they have to do something different?
Well, actually, it's funny that you bring this up. So, you know, I'll share that during this pandemic, I gave a lot of virtual talks and all, but right. I remember when it started in March of last year, and I saw how our fellow speakers and, you know, my fellow professors were having really hard time with Zoom, never right. have used it before. And how do you deliver a really high quality presentation over it? And I remember that I saw that and it broke my heart. And I said, you know how to use that. Why don't I shoot this video? And I shot a video and I posted it on YouTube and I posted it on Facebook. Hey, you know, if you're having a hard time, just go there. And you remember, Ron, when somebody would ask a question there, sometimes all of a sudden you're going to get a call from me trying to help you out there. That was one of the most fulfilling things that I did during that.
Giving that back. Year. I mean, it was just phenomenal. I mean, the way you gave back during the most difficult times when we were all trying to navigate very difficult waters.
It wasn't about trust. It was, but the funny thing that happened was that those videos, they got watched so much and I started getting a lot of subscribers. It actually took over my YouTube channel to the point where I had to start a second channel. I now have a second channel.
Remember seeing that. Yes.
Yeah. The second channel is called thetrustshow.com as well. The Trust Show. Thetrustshow.com takes you to my podcast, but the video channel about trust is called The Trust Show on YouTube. But I had to separate it out because all of a sudden people on the first channel were just expecting to see videos on how to use OBS, how to use it over Zoom, how to use Stream Deck. Then I started using Touch Portal and so on. And every now and then I still shoot another video explaining something, how to choose a microphone, how to choose a camera and so on.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Well, before we say goodbye, just real quick, four components of business success, which we covered in detail, but I'm just going to run through them real quick. Differentiation, which is extremely important. Unique target market, competitive advantage, and probably the most important of all, a viable business model. And if you don't have all four, then you're going to be struggling to get to that success that you really want to enjoy the most. So Dr. Solomon, thank you again so much for being with me today and for contributing to this conversation. I could listen to you for hours, and I hope that you'll come back and join me again some other time. For those of you watching, thank you so much for participating today, and we will see you some other time. Goodbye, everybody.